I kind of think maybe I should have gone in the morning. I actually have an example of a reef that's still doing all right this morning, so I'm going to end with that, you know, so you have something to look forward to. But I'm just going to basically talk today about some work that we've been developing at UM over the last decade or so, using imaging technology for mapping and monitoring coral reefs. And then I'm going to show you some examples of where we've been using them, how we use them, and then specifically, related to some of the things that we talked about earlier, and look at how we're using this in a specific area, looking at bleaching and resistance and resilience patterns. So if you're involved with coral reef monitoring management, you know that there are a lot of different ways that we go and we assess the coral reef. You can go and do line transects, you can do a video transect, photographing individual colonies. We're all basically trying to, we have the same goal, we're trying to get the same information. And the primary goal is to document what's there. That sounds like a really easy thing, but this is such a complicated system. There's so many different types of organisms out there. This is actually a really complicated question. We do that because we want to know how are these resources faring? Are they declining? Are we seeing any recovery? And that aids in our ability to understand how these different processes, including events, like disease events, are affecting these coral communities. And that leads to good management. But when we started this process, we realized that there were some pretty big drawbacks to most of the ways that we assess coral reefs. The primary one is that we treat them like they're science experiments. We decide what is important before we even get in the water. Most of the time, that's things like coral cover. A lot of people measure coral cover in a lot of different ways. But if you have an event that comes and affects all of your sponge population, you're not going to be able to measure that change if you focus on your coral cover. So we have this problem of we're always making these a priori decisions. So it's not a bad thing, it's just the way that we approach things. And because we do that, we tend to miss certain aspects of this very complex coral community. So we can only measure change if the right metrics aren't collected. And that is a cumulative process. So we're not going to be very good at understanding these patterns and processes if we're not documenting and measuring change in a systematic way that actually captures the information that we're looking for. So where do we go? And so we were seeing in landscape ecology that they had tools that we didn't. So this is a picture of the Bolivian rainforest in 1975. And just by showing it to you, you can see the aerial extent of the Bolivian rainforest. If you follow it through time, you can track the changes. You can see that most of this rainforest was clear cut and for agricultural purposes. And that the change between these two has been significant. It's an incredible visual record of what is happening in this area. The important thing, though, is that we didn't have to know that it was going to be clear cut in order to measure the change. And this is really the benefit of using image-based technologies for monitoring. You don't have to know what is going to happen. You have a record, and you can not only look and see, but you can measure what that change is using imagery. So that's really where we wanted to focus. We realized there was a big gap. We have information from satellites for things like temperature, mapping, the area and spatial distribution of different reefs. And underwater, we can take individual pictures of colonies, but we didn't have anything really in between these two really relevant scales. So that's where we've really been working over the last several years, is trying to develop imaging techniques that cover areas that are bigger than an individual coral, but obviously a bit smaller than the total reef track scale. So we use downward looking imagery. We take a diver out to the reef and we collect a lot of images. And we're doing still images, we're taking images once a second on the reef. We're doing video, it's constant. And basically they swim back and forth and back and forth over the reef, trying to get high overlap over the area. We then basically use feature matching algorithms to match the features of one image. every other Indigenous data set. That allows us to match, you know, successive passes and to create a single seamless image map of the area. So we can use basically any type of imagery, underwater video. The highest resolution ones that we do today are with dual digital SLR cameras. We use GoPros a lot. They're really cheap. They're pretty indestructible. And so a lot of people are really fond a lot of these for GoPros. The ones that we don't recommend are these little handheld ones that are above water and below. They're really not made for motion, so they're often just very blurry. So this is... You press the cool video. This is the end product, and this is one of the categories that I'm going to be talking about later. Basically, this is a single, spatially explicit image that was made up of thousands of composite images. But basically, it gives you a snapshot of what did that reef actually look like at the time of the surface. You can see different begonias, different species of corals, all from a single view. You can zoom, kind of have your own little and when we're using multiple cameras, we can do a second level of information. So we'll often swim with both a wide angle and a close-up. And so we'll take the same feature matching algorithms that we used before, and we'll match the features of the close-up camera to the mosaic. So that allows us to basically give you another viewer that's also just on our website. You can go and you'll see all these little tiny yellow dots, which you probably can see. But each one of those dots is high-resolution. So you have an archive of really high-resolution information over the entire space of your area of interest. So we can look at things like areas of brush mortality. We can look at things like mapology. So it's, as I said, it's an incredible archive of what that reef looks like at a given point in time. We've done a lot of comparisons. These are not just pretty pictures. We've compared things like percent cover, that goes in the water, to percent cover analysis just of the mosaic image. Same thing with coral colony sizes, distances. We can do all of those things directly from these images. So kind of shifting the effort from the field into the lab. And there's a wide range of applications for these. We've had people who wanted to do fairly large areas, 5 kilometers, but they wanted smaller, just tiny little for satellite mapping. So we wanted to do small areas, but over a larger area. These are minute mosaics, so these are taken 3 minutes in the field, and you get an image that covers 20 to 40 square meters. Opposite end of that spectrum is very large areas. This one's 40,000 square meters. This is a ship grounding area off Palmyra Atoll. And that one's created with over 300,000 images that took to create that. Took 2 days just to collect that information with a tone survey. So these tools can be modified based on, you know, the questions that you're asking or the areas that you're interested in surveying. But the real benefit of these, by far, is for change. As I mentioned before, the real benefit of the Landsat imagery was that you didn't have to know what the disturbance was in order to measure the change. And so this is another data set of opportunity. We've been monitoring this in Chorpatch Reef for a few years. This is it in 2008. And then in 2010, we had a home bar event here in Florida. It had significant mortality in the Chorpatch Reef. And we have a graduate student that went and remosaic this area after the cold water mortality. And just using the image, you're able to look at which corals survived, which didn't. What species, what size were they? So it's an incredible resource for looking back and seeing how this entire community has really changed. You know, she was able to look at not only these are corals, red is total mortality, yellow is partial mortality, but the rest of the coral, the rest of the Benthic community as well. Judah, Lemaitre, and cresting gorgonias were actually the largest hit. That's something we may not ever usually measure with our typical survey methodologies. Erect sponges, erect gorgonian sponges as well, were all in this cold water event. Also, on a different time scale, we can also use these images with the high resolution to look at early indications of recovery. If we're just looking at percent cover over time, it's going to take a very, very long time, even if there is recovery, to be able to detect it. So things like this, where we're actually looking at the same colony over time, we can start to give you indicators of recovery. We are also using these images for outplanting. This is a ship grounding in Puerto Rico. We mapped it in 2010. NOAA's been working very hard to use nursery reef corals. And you can see here, this is 2014, and this is 2015, a significant increase in the progress of recurrence of these sites. And they were able to measure those changes using just these images as well. So as I mentioned, these are an excellent resource for documenting what we have, measuring those changes, because we don't have to know if the disease event from white plague is going to come and affect it, but if it did, we could measure how the community has changed over time. And this is helping us gather better benefit information and understand these processes a bit more. So this is a program that, or a project that I'm working on in association with NOAA. Down near Island Morada at Chica Rocks. There are six sites there as part of NOAA's National Coral Reef Monitoring Program. And we've been monitoring this area since 2012. We do an annual sampling. And so this was an excellent area with which to document the last 2 years of bleaching. We did additional sampling in September of 2014 and March of 2015 to document the height of bleaching in 2014. And the recovery 6 months later. So this is just an example of one of those six sites over time. This is 2012 through 2014. Here's the September, this is the bleaching image. You can actually see a bunch of the little white colonies even at this scale. March is the recovered image, and this is the secondary bleaching image in October of 2015. But we're gonna focus mostly on this. I'll give an update on how this reef has been faring more recently at the end. But if you can click on that again, there's another little reef. So, as I said, these are great for documenting change over time. On the left is a bleaching image in September of 2014, and this is March of 2015. We can put them side by side, and then a single image show you the disturbance and show you the recovery. So you can see that the majority of corals have actually regained their pigmentation, but there are areas of significant partial mortality. And you can do this, though, in a single viewer that I can give you a website, and you can go to it and look at it online. You can even probably pick it up on your phone. So these are events that most people are never gonna see. Even the people in this room, whether or not you got out to the height of the bleaching, in the last 2 years, maybe questionable, but the majority of people will never see them. But now we have a tool where we can show them. We can show them the extent of a bleaching event as more than just a single image frame. And then we can use it to learn. Here we are fate tracking all of the colonies within these sites. So we basically brought these images back to the lab, we digitized them. And started with over 5,000 coral colonies over these six sites. And we're following them through time. We're doing this level of information because we're very interested. This is an ocean acidification study site. They're very interested in the carbonate budgets. And so they want to know exactly how much of each species that are in these areas. But it allows us to answer interesting questions about these coral communities. We can look at, because we have before information, are any of these corals resistant to coral bleaching? When we looked at bleaching, how did that relate 6 months later? Was this a predictor of mortality or not? And are there any factors that predispose these corals to mortality after this community event. So this is just showing, this is the thermal anomaly that we saw in 2014. We did see significant bleaching, so over 50% at this site. But as you can see in 2015, in March, most of the corals had repigmented. Overall, we saw about 72.8% bleaching. It did range pretty significantly from 50% to about 84% over these six different sites. But in terms of bleaching susceptibility, species-wide, 11 out of the 22 species had more than 90% of bleach. That means they were either pale, partially bleached, or bleached. So that means most of the corals on this reef were susceptible to bleaching in 2014. Notably, there are some exceptions. Sideraxis, Sideria, Stephanocene, Intercepta had ranges in the 30%. But when we went back in March, we wanted to see if the colony was there in 2014, is it still there in 2015? And there was 99% survival in terms of whole colony mortality. So we finally have something that's doing okay, knock on wood. we have high survival at this site between 2014 and March of 2015. But that doesn't mean that nothing happened. We also looked at partial mortality. We found total tissue loss was about 3.7%. So that includes both total mortality and partial mortality of each of these individuals. And looking at the different species, we found that it was very variable. Some species didn't seem to have any partial mortality or bulk or total colony mortality, but species like Orbicella populata at about 43.6%. So that's a majority of the, 43% of the corals had some form of mortality. Related species though, Montastria or Orbicella angularis only had 6%. So we do see that there's differences in the different species and how they reacted to this thermal anomaly. We also used information that we collected prior to this event to look at if there was anything that predisposed these corals to mortality during this event. And of those corals that we looked at, those that had never experienced mortality before, 13% of those had partial mortality following this event. But those that had previous partial mortality, that rate went up to 48%. So there was obviously, if a colony had experienced mortality prior to this, it was much more likely to experience mortality during this event. But we're also using these as basically a map for other studies. This is something I'm working on with Paul Jones at NOAA. And during this event, he was able to map the different symbiont types. This is in September of 2014. And look, I don't know if you can see it, but it basically shows a fairly diverse community in September. We see a lot of this type A, this green splotches, and some of these red dots, which is this clade D, a thermally tolerant type. But when we look 6 months later, it's almost entirely clade B and clade D in Orbicella fabulata. So we see this shifting of symbionts to a more tolerant type over this time period. And why that might be important is that in 2015, we have another thermal anomaly, and this one was actually stronger at Chica Rocks than the 2014 event. But if you look at these images side by side, press that again. So on the left, this is September 16th of 2014, and this is October 9th of 2015. You'll see, looking at the exact same corals a year later, also during a bleaching event, we see less muted bleaching. So corals that were previously completely bleached may only be pale or partially bleached between time periods. Even though the summer thermal anomaly in this area was stronger, actually 34% stronger during the summer of 2015. So whether or not those symbiont shifting helped reduce the susceptibility of these corals to bleaching is something we're looking into. But not only did we see muted responses in terms of bleaching, We also saw less mortality in the year of 2015. So you would assume, I would assume, in multiple legion years that those effects might be compounded. But we found that here's mortality. So this is either partial or total colony mortality in 2014. And then very little partial or total colony mortality in 2015. So just kind of overall, I want to show this to you today and show you that we can now use these types of imaging techniques to collect information on thousands of coral colonies in a very short amount of time in the field. This Chica example, each of those plots takes about 40 minutes in the field to actually take the images so that we can make the mosaic. And we're hoping that this is going to help with this shifting baselines problem. Every time we go out, if we've had a successive disease event or bleaching event, and we see less and less corals, that's kind of what we see in the normal. We know that that's not true. This is a way to actually get rid of that problem. We can go back in time and look and see how much has this community, how much has it actually changed. The ability to show the disturbance and the recovery side by side is a really powerful tool. It's very quick, it's very easy, and you know, most people are much more visual than they are when you tell them, you know, percentages or statistics. So we can show them what are these disturbances that are happening on the coral reefs. From the September 24th meeting event, we did see an example here of a fairly resilient community. There was low total colony mortality, and we found that, you know, bleaching susceptibility and partial mortality declined from 2014 to 2015. We're hoping to continue to use this data set to look at these processes and ask questions about resistance and resilience over time. And with that, I will take any questions that you might have. Yes?
Yeah, you mentioned as a tool, it looks like you're using stereo to measure cover. Is this two-dimensional footprint cover, or is this three-dimensional cover?
Yeah, it's two-dimensional cover. You can use the same type of setup to get a three-dimensional picture, but most of the analyses that we've done, and especially when we've compared it to divers, it's all been from two-dimensional. Yeah?
I maybe missed it in the beginning, but after you digitize your images, how are you actually quantifying things like cover? Is it, and it appears that you're doing tracing.
Yeah, so for that example, it's through basically area, you know, how much of the area is occupied by the corals. But you can use these just like you would a video transect and do point counts and things like that on the image as well. This is just a kind of a much more detailed community look.
Okay, so you have an automated...
That's the holy grail. That is what everybody is looking at, and we just haven't had a lot of success with that, with the tools that we've encountered yet. It's getting there, and once it's there, being able to put in, you know, an entire community or, you know, a much larger area at one time, I'm very excited to see that. Yeah.
It's kind of a continuation of just the first question, but have you considered using 3D photography for this? I see like a top-down method and doing really interesting reefs that have a lot of structure, and it seems like if you use an image to see the video, you can actually click through it like Google Maps and do
That's absolutely where things are going right now. And there are some really, really awesome examples of that. But for, you know, we started this in 2012, so especially for historical data sets, we want to maintain, you know, the same metrics. The other problem with 3D right now is that it is more the experimental. So, you know, making those measurements and seeing how those relate to real world characteristics, that leap hasn't been made yet. So we don't know how accurate some of these, you know, models are in terms of these sorts of measurements. But we're going to get there. Yeah.
Okay, so here's the big question about moving forward, because so far this is about photography basically. So the next stumbling block is getting down to the level of cell molecular knowledge. And the stumbling block for the last 16 years has been the willingness of folks to be moderators, allowing folks who do that sort of work to take the sample. So would you allow someone to come in and take biopsies off corals on those sites?
Well, that's sadly, that's not my, I don't have any control over those are permitting issues. But that's what we have permits to do. I'm working with people who are working on those things. And so, yes, we're using these as maps for the.
Would you be philosophically opposed to someone requesting a permit?
No. If it were small enough, it would depend on the scale.
Size report.
Yeah, no. I think there's so much information that we can gather from that. And especially if we start to relate it as, a bigger scale. Things like the symbiotic, we're looking at that on not just one species, but I would love to see it for the whole thing so that we can, actually see how this community responded. Those are questions we can't answer, or the cost of doing it is prohibitive right now, but we're getting to the point where I think it would be really interesting.
So the problem we had is we had the technology to do stuff like that. So for example, I would make the A priori prediction that AP generates less reactive oxygen species from photosystem II. We need to go out and measure that. And our stumbling blocks since the late 90s was that the folks who had digital images of individual corals that we see, here are the corals that never produce, here are the ones that we should recover. And you'd also sample some others that probably should die. We could then look at those, and we weren't allowed to do it.
Yeah.
So we're sitting here 15 years later, maybe someone said,
no, I mean, those are the questions that you look at these images and you're like, you have to be answering. Yes. Especially because we're getting to this point where we may have annual bleaching in Florida in the near future. And not just like a decade, but maybe less than that. And so this is an example of that sort of experience. And we need to know which of these corals, and that's a very small percentage. I think it was 7% that had no bleaching in either year. So, but that's an important 7%. Why are they not bleaching? Or, even if they did bleach, the corals that didn't have the partial mortality versus the ones that did, what are the differences,
And are they viable reproductive?
Right, exactly. And this is one of these intra countries are healthier by far than the offshore reefs. And we don't really understand the mechanisms of why, and those are just really important. Hope you can get the credibility and I can give you the time.
Yes, so I'll answer that question. Yeah. You haven't answered that. We're now in 18 years. Partially answers.
John, I can speak to the fact that as management, we are looking at that. I think we've never been able to allow for sampling of transect areas because we have comparatively fewer corals in that transect area to try to say what we needed to say. So looking at this population level will give us more comfort.
Yeah, each of these sites is about 30% coral numbers. These are one of the highest in the Florida community that was chosen for that reason.
Instead of the individual synchronous sites that only have maybe 50 corals per area.
The correct sites are what we're thinking of. And at the time, they had plenty of corals. But there's the unwillingness to. They said, we can sample the corals that were just outside the plot. That's like saying that I've got some disease near sample dam. That makes no sense. And so, of course, we didn't do it. I mean, the other option was we could have done it and then just suffered the consequences of basically having to do it. Looking back, should we have done it? I don't know. Maybe we should. We'd be way further ahead. So I'm glad that you're open with this. Because this is what we need to do. This is becoming about biomedical scholars. You've got to know that the history of your patient. And then sample those patients, not some others that are having a medical history.
Yeah. Yes.
Are you set up so that folks can go take video in the field, send it to you, and
we work with a number of groups. It's usually a process of we have certain protocols that we'll tell you about and go and collect things. But we work especially with people who are more remotely, price scale up for that. For small areas, they're pretty cheap and quick, but, you know, for really big areas, it takes a lot more time. So it really depends.